I thought we would start this session to put it in context, to give you a historical perspective. I think what we're seeing now, the vast flows of capital across border, is something that is relatively new in a sense. Although I would say that this, if you look back 30, 40 years ago, the flows are really very, very small compared to what we are seeing now. In the 60s, we have a few British companies moving across border. I mean, names like, some of you will remember MEPC, Amazon, and even British Land went out, but they retreated, and I think it's only Grosvenor estate that's now actually engaged in serious cross-border investment. And then in the 70s, we have the Dutch institution doing that. In the 80s, the Japanese. And in the 90s, not a lot, partly because in the early 90s, the property markets were in big trouble at that time. And then we started to see significant cross flows, in fact, from different directions. Just a few years before the great financial recession. And then, of course, when GFC happened, the whole thing just fell off, but things have picked up a lot since then. So my first question to the panel will be, what are the differences pre-GFC and post-GFC, right? What are the characteristics, the players, the size of funds, and so on? I think I looking at the panel here, the guy that's closest to my vintage, it's probably John Zehner. Let's start with John.
Good afternoon, everyone. I have to start by telling you a fun little anecdote. My accent makes it clear that I'm an American, but I haven't lived in the country for 20 years. And sometimes I get confused culturally. So when we were standing down here getting ready to come up on stage, I offered my Tic Tacs to the rest of my panelists, and I didn't fully understand why they got nervous and backed up a couple steps. Anyway, they explained it to me. Well, Seek, I guess I'll start by saying that post the global financial crisis, in my mind, three things have happened. One is leverage levels have come down. Two, control has become more important. And so you get big investors who are less willing to invest in funds where they have no control. And three, I would tell you that somehow the pace of international capital investing around the world has gone up dramatically.
Jack, would you like to add to that?
Yeah, no, I think the, I'd agree with John. I think you had a different relationship in sort of in the run-up to the GFC. Hopefully not the cause, between cap rates and where risk-free rates were. You certainly had a substantial amount of debt leverage that was available then that's not available now. But I think sort of, Seek, I think two things now. You had in the 06, 07, you had the sort of the exuberant animal spirits driving the market. That had been very strong returns. People just couldn't go fast enough. And I think now, as people are looking at the world now, I think the prevailing view is that everything's pretty fully priced. Nothing's particularly cheap. Everyone who's trying to meet pension liabilities or pay insurance claims is struggling to stay solvent. And I think the last thing is the central banks. You know, the central banks are really driving the sort of the value of risk assets and the amount of liquidity in the system. And so I think we're spending as much time trying to handicap them as we are on the property markets.
Peter, from a perspective of a sovereign wealth fund?
Although I have to caution, just for formality, we're actually not a sovereign wealth. We're a pension fund, so we do actually try to differentiate ourselves. Not that I want to disagree with the moderator on the very first question. I think I would parse it into two categories. Clearly, real estate is in favor these days. It's a very attractive asset class for those who are looking for yield, stability, et cetera. But if we're trying to differentiate what's happened now between what's happened previously, I think what's temporal is that we have low interest rates. And when I say temporal, I don't mean I predict interest rates to go up tomorrow, but I don't think it's sustainable that we will have zero interest rates for the next 25 years. What I do think is a structural difference that is going to impact capital flows for the foreseeable future is large pools of capital continuing to exert their buying power. There are big pools of capital from Asia, there's big pools of capital in the Middle East, Europe, etc. And those pools of capital, the US and Canada, of course, are not going to be very, what I would say, spooked by interest rate movements or whatnot. This is permanent capital that's committed to real estate, and they will provide some stabilization to pricing that I think will be good for real estate over the long run.
Michael, from the standpoint of a company that is, if you like, a recipient of some of these funds in JVs around the world, how do you see this?
I think clearly the other thing to add into the equation is one of the things that has been affected by the crisis but was already in process is on the demand side. The nature of demand drivers to create, you know, the yields that Peter is after, they've been changing. And so, I'm sure we can come back to that later, but I just throw that into the mix, that while at the same time that there's more capital being allocated looking for sustainable yield, which is really what
perhaps
it's seeking in the real estate, that the nature of how that yield's created is changing.
Well, let's come back to that question. I think it's a very important one in a low interest environment for so long, and it looks like it's going to continue for a little while, that it really is a situation where a lot of pressure is put on the cap rates or yields, or another way of putting it, that things look expensive in general. So how sustainable it is, what do you do? Is there a change in strategy? What should be your asset allocation? What's your holding period, and where do you find the opportunities? Anybody wants to take that on?
I want to hear the answers.
So I'll take this.
I think the, it's interesting. See, you can look and say cap rates in the U.S. are between 4% and 5%. Things are wildly expensive. Sell everything and sort of put in a coffee can in your backyard. I think when you look more broadly and think what can you get in bonds, what can you get in equities, what can you get in commodities, some of these asset classes, astonishingly, making a 4% or 5% income yield, having some inflation hedge, having some prospect for capital preservation and maybe some growth depending on how well you do, actually ends up being fairly attractive. And so you're seeing, as Peter was saying, you're seeing an awful lot of people, you're seeing a lot of traditional capital sources, being pushed into this asset class. We are also seeing some non-traditional buyers, high net worth, sort of wealthy families, saying that if you can buy, if you can get a leverage 6, that's probably a winner. That's probably about as good as you can get. And so the whole metrics, I think a lot of us are being challenged by these low rates and think, what actually are the right metrics to be thinking about?
I do think what's, despite my previous comments that there's some permanent capital for real estate, which I think is good for the sector and the industry, there's no doubt a lot of the capital that is in the sector is because the comparison is to putting your money in bonds and all that. And I do think there is a risk factor that people aren't fully anticipating, that some of that capital is faster capital that might not be quite as committed. So I think it's very important, especially if the audience is, thinking about investing and whatnot, you have to look at the type of the real estate that you're investing in, because the real estate we're talking about is probably the AAA properties in Midtown Manhattan or the trophy malls or UK. Maybe that's a good or bad example these days. But I think it's very important that we kind of differentiate that, because the pricing is, in our mind, extremely expensive for the type of real estate I just described. there's a whole set of real estate that isn't in favor with large capital investors, and that might be trading at a not the same premium. So I think there is a differentiating pricing structure that's evolving because of the different types of capital out there.
And first of all, we'll pick up the conversation about permanent capital, because I think there's some sovereign wealth funds out there that thought they were investing permanently and they might need some of that money back. Yeah. sooner rather than later. First of all, I think, and Jack touched on this, the geopolitical risk out there, we're talking about interest rates, but there's a great deal of geopolitical risk out there, and a lot of the capital flowing into real estate is just looking for a safe haven. And if you look at what's going on in the Middle East, if you look what's going on in China and Hong Kong, maybe even Brexit, you know, people want a safe home, and that's driving a lot of this. I think that they are focused on quality locations because one of the other lessons learned in the global financial crisis is not to invest in secondary and tertiary assets. And I think people are still remembering that, and that's a real issue. The other answer I would give to your question, Seek, is debt. I think real estate debt right now, given what's happening in the CMBS market and the bank market, more and more institutions are going into both senior debt and mezzanine debt, and I think that's providing a safe yield that it's attractive to many institutional investors.
The other thing that's happening, and I think it's still too early to know for sure, but it seems that as the weight of capital and allocations into real estate are likely to be higher than they have been historically looking forward, investors are looking at longer term holding of the assets. And time will tell, but a recent, you know, in Europe, a ULI study looked at ownership among 50 major institutional investors. It was tied to it was actually part of a climate change study. And it came to something which surprised me, but actually 20% of the assets by those 50 institutions were held for more than 20 years, right? I suspect that number is gonna grow. And it comes, and then as the holding of assets for a longer term, I mean, real estate's always been long term, right? We've been through this period though, and there's all kinds of ways to go in and out quickly, but it is a long term asset. And the risks, of course, as you look out longer term, are the things you have to think about, right? So the Brexit, the geopolitics, that falls in the short term bucket. And things will jump around. But longer term, there are also big looming things that are already in the picture. You know, climate change to start with, but also technology, right? I mean, how is technology affecting a real estate asset that you're buying with a certain yield, but how is that yield profile gonna be affected by these mega looming challenges, right? Those are all things that make it more interesting.
Well, Jack alluded to the fact, I think several of the speakers, about well, institutional investors don't just look at real estate per se, they look across all the different asset classes. And if bonds, if you're lucky to get you 1%, 6% return from core real estate looks very good, right? For the moment. Long term, now we don't know where interest rates are going to be, but this abnormally low interest rate been here for a long time. The Fed is struggling to try and raise interest rate. So nobody could say when the ugly head of inflation and interest rates are going to rise. Let's say we get, if I can quote, interest rate returning to normal in 5 years' time. What do you think it's going to do to cap rate and what's going to do to the underlying value when yields or cap rates are so low? I mean, is there what is the thinking now as far as your asset allocation strategy is concerned?
I would tell you that that's not the risk that's on the top of most investors' minds. It is not interest rates increasing, because I think the prospect of them increasing in a significant way is so far out in the future that they're now accepting the fact that for the next 5 years, they're staying roughly where they are.
Yeah, I think you sort of say, is it good? Is our interest rates good or bad? To the extent that they're driven by economic growth and the banking system's finally healing itself, and that leads to an inflation in replacement costs, and you're able to grow rents something like with inflation, then I think, you know, as the risk-free rate goes up, you get a little bit of cushioning on the spread, and eventually cap rates go up. And so I think you have to think about it like a teeter-totter. You have rising rates, and if you can rise your income, then it's in balance. If you have no ability to grow your income, then you've got a one-way trade the wrong way. That's sort of how we're thinking about it. But I'd agree with John. There's a, you know, our guys keep quoting lower for longer with volatility, which I don't know exactly what that means, but it means it's a bumpy ride, and you know, nobody's worried about, you know, the next Fed rate increase particularly.
Yeah, I agree with Jack. I think another way to phrase it is we don't think in terms of cap rates. I think cap rates is a very useful tool to compare sale prices. I mean, we think on as a total return. And so if you think that your asset's going to grow 6%, you're fine with a 3% cap rate because you're going to be getting a 9%. There's obviously taking off CapEx. But in general, you're looking at it as a total return. So reinforcing Jack's comments, if you think that interest rates are rising because, or in fact they are rising because of growth, et cetera, in your asset, then you're less concerned. If you have a situation like, for example, in Brazil, where interest rates rose without any economic growth, that's a huge problem, and you saw that in the real estate pricing. And so it really depends on why are interest rates rising, or conversely, why are they staying flat? Is as much of a, I think, today's conversation as opposed to what's happened, why they're going to increase. What is wrong with the economy such that interest rates are so low, and then how does that impact your real estate? And that is a more immediate issue that everyone has to deal with right now.
Do you think institutional investors would be adjusting their hurdle rate down? Or have they?
I think they have already.
So how much do you think we've adjusted that for core returns? So is it used to be, I'm not saying anything, but 8 or 10%, is that still too high?
For core?
For core.
Yes. No, I think Jack's 4 to 5% initial yields comment was probably a U.S. comment. I think in other parts of the world, you know, in Germany and Taiwan, it begins with a 3 and every now and then a 2.
You're talking about initial yields.
Initial yields.
What about total return? Let's talk about total return.
Total return.
Peter's point.
We're having conversations about 5% total returns.
Wow. So I think we're having conversations where our clients are looking at our 5-year forecast returns by asset class, which vary from -2 to 5. And so I think, you know, with fixed income below zero and equities and, you know, maybe the mid single digits. And so getting a 5%, if you could get something like 5% of in cash with a little bit of leverage from real estate, it's sort of a lot of green lights are flashing on the allocation models.
I agree that there are deals transacting at those returns, total returns in the 5, maybe 5s is a little low, to be honest, but let's say 6s. I don't know who really thinks they're getting 5s, but let's even grant it at a 6 or something like that. I don't think there's as deep a pool of buyers anymore at that pricing. We've been in the market selling for the last several years, and 2 or 3 years ago, there would be a lineup of investors that would buy. I'd say back then, I must say, it was close to the mid-6s. And it would be a deep pool. You'd have a list of 5 or 6, and you'd look at those who could execute and close. We've had some properties, I should be more discreet, but this is a private conversation, I assume?
Yeah, private. Yeah.
The lights are so bright, I can't see if there's anyone in the audience or not. But the depth of buyers is much thinner than before. So there are not that list of 5 or 6 that are willing to step in and take those 6 IRRs, in my view, or at least for the assets.
Well, Mike, you know, you guys have a lot of JVs with foreign investors. What they're looking for, what kind of return?
Well,
is it -2, like Jack said, or plus 5?
I think it's the conversations, maybe, I don't know how many drinks John had had when he got his 5%, but
thank you, now, Michael.
Of course, investors will still tell you, look, the reality is it's all down to what is the risk they're buying into, right? But for true core, for truly sustainable yield, right? And that's the thing, who can say what a truly sustainable yield is? But for truly, you know, for true core, that's not a broadened definition of core. Mm. Yeah, 6% is an acceptable total return.
And just to be clear, lest everybody disagree with me too easily, if you're a German pension fund and you're investing in Germany and you're buying true core, which is what many of them want to buy, 5% is the number, unleveraged.
We need to start marketing in Germany more, I think.
Well, no, but it makes
that sense.
Sounds a lot. There are size limitations. Makes, they're not 300 million right. euro assets.
It's a cost of capital question.
The pension funds in Europe, you know, looking at what they need to do and looking at what their alternatives are, you know, there isn't a lot of sovereign debt that they want to be buying at this point.
That's above zero.
Right? Yeah. Right? Sitting on cash is expensive, literally.
That's a dangerous game because bonds move much quicker than real estate.
That's true.
You know, one of the reasons we're saying people hold on to their assets, real estate, as we all know, is a far less liquid asset than most other asset classes. So while interest rates might move up, and no one's expecting them to drop 300 basis points, but your liquidity is going to move even slower. So it's a very dangerous game if you think you can match short-term debt with your long-term fixed real estate.
I prefer to summarize this differently. You can invest with LaSalle and get a 5% return or BlackRock in a negative 0.2.
All right, now it's getting interesting. Why are they sitting
so far? That's one way to look at it.
But the trick is, how do you get investors prepared to invest with you expecting minus 2% return?
Well, no, listen,
that's not so easy.
Yeah, I mean, listen, but you know what people are doing? People are buying European sovereign debt at those rates. I mean, that's not, nobody's selling it to them. People are that's the cost of holding cash right now in that asset class. And every big institutional investor is sort of being pushed into something like credit, something like income. And so I think what you're seeing is that, I think the clever investors are trying to figure out how do you get out of that trade into something else that feels like credit that has actually a positive yield. But I think the institutional capital is getting a little more creative and nimble for exactly the reason that Peter described. It's really hard to...
I kind of agree with Peter that if you're playing this bond game, which can move very quickly, a small change in interest rate makes a big difference to the underlying bond value. And suddenly, you might get a huge number of investors wanted the exit, and you find there are only two doors that are open. And that's when we will get a significant revelation in the market.
Yeah, and I agree, Seek, but if you're a pension fund, many of these pension funds are underinvested as it is, and the difference between make it up a 6% yield and a 5% yield on real estate and a 0% yield in fixed income, boy, that has an impact on your portfolio. It's a very significant one. So I think, of course, as always, it's diversification and balance to try to protect yourself against some of these unpredictable events.
How do you do it? At CPPIB.
One of, I think, CPPs, we're not unique, but at CPP, we don't have allocations. We don't have targets that we have to invest in real estate. It's really only if it's of an incremental value to the fund. And so by not having allocations, we're only investing if we think we're actually, because our fund, I don't want to advertise too much, but we don't have cash. We invest immediately in a portfolio of stocks and bonds. And we only acquire real estate if we think it can outperform on a risk-adjusted basis the stocks and bonds that we're selling to finance it. So it kind of keeps us very tempered. And that's where we have to have views on debt and equity. So it's not a perfect system because you have to have some predictions how the equity and debt will perform. To answer your question more specifically, that's the philosophy. What are we doing today? And, you know, is that practically we have pulled back from some of this trophy real estate that we recognize as fabulous real estate. Our job is not to just deploy real estate in low-risk assets. Our job is to maximize return without undue risk. And so we're constantly actually looking for risk because that way we can get higher returns. What are we seeing today? We're trying to go into markets where there's dislocations. We purchased some office buildings in Calgary, which is the Canadian oil market. We've been making some investments in China these days, as China is becoming a less favorable market for some investors. We've been looking in the UK, although even with Brexit, UK isn't that cheap yet, but we're hoping that there'd be some buying opportunities. We've been very active in Brazil, a market that actually has suffered quite a bit. And we're not unique. I don't want to suggest we're the only ones down there. There's a lot of very other sophisticated capital in Brazil right now. So we're trying to work around the edges. We're going into new sectors, things like that.
Do you see many investors doing the same thing, picking the down markets and the generally, I would say, pretty buoyant investment market in the developed world? Do you see other players going to Brazil, for example, to take counter-cyclical investments? Do you see many of these? China?
Michael should answer this, I think.
Yeah. Look, Brazil, if you look globally, Brazil is a fairly... It seems like a pretty opportune time. It's been huge disruption and the beginnings of a shift in sentiment. So now is the right time to be investing cyclically in Brazil. And more broadly in the developing world, clearly there continues, I think most investors continue to recognize, I had one discussion recently with one who characterized a 10% yield in India feels good to them because there's some room in that, right? The real risk, getting back to some of the earlier discussion, yields have compressed, right? The real risk is in things that have never yielded, have had yields this low, and that's where the real risk is, I think, more so than in trophy core real estate. I think that's the real risk, where people are stretching their definitions of core to just chase yield. But alongside that, there has to be room for investing in developing markets, because that's where the growth is.
Sure. Here we're talking about opportunities in developing or emerging markets where you get better, higher returns. But that also implies higher risk. Is it necessarily so? I mean, a lot of the time, the fear of unknown is where you hit it with a big premium.
Right.
But if it becomes known, then you don't require as high a premium. So are you saying that's why you're looking at emerging markets?
If I may answer that.
Sure.
I agree with you that the unknown is where you get extra, but also ease of access or difficulty of access. Not all investors can go to Brazil. Us and a few of our peers, we're not alone, have offices in Brazil. And so for us, it's not the fear of the unknown at all. It's we have access to that. If we weren't in Brazil, it'd be a lot harder. And that is where, it's not necessarily that we're smarter capital, we have more capital that allows us to do things that smaller investors can't do. We have a physical presence in these markets, and it gives us access. So it's the ability to transact, not just the knowledge to do it.
Okay. You know, I think cross-border investing started with sort of a 25 basis points for every time zone from headquarters, right? The farther away it is, the bigger return you needed. I think there's a lot of organizations who have global footprints, who are local players, who can invest alongside the domestic pension funds and the domestic insurance companies, you know, the guys who really set value in these markets. And then, yeah, I think a lot of shops like ours and other folks are trying to find, you know, dislocations are great, but even if there's a seam, you know, maybe not a dislocation, but based on size or risk factor, you know, some way to get into an asset where there isn't, you know, a pile of capital getting in. And I think a lot of our jobs are to try to find those.
Do you think, I mean, let's get to sort of more practical things, like Peter talked about having offices on the ground. How important is that in doing serious cross-border investment to actually have feet on the ground?
Critical.
Listen, I think it's a table stake. I think anybody who does it, who invests without that, is going to get what they deserve.
Right.
What happens, Jack? Sorry.
If your money that's flying in on a deal that all the smart money and all the smart people in town have passed on, that's, you know, those aren't the deals you want to be doing.
So do you see, I mean, I know Jack and John, and to some extent Tishman, Michael, are fund managers. So to what extent do you see that there's now an increasing trend of institutional investors, sovereign wealth funds, and pension funds?
Thank you.
I actually knew that. I thought you might be able to speak on behalf of the other sovereign funds, which I can't.
I'll try to. Yeah.
But my question really is, to what extent do you see that there is a trend towards them doing more direct investment, not unlike what CPPIB has been doing for a while, or almost? And how is that affecting the fund management business in general?
Yes, it's a trend. I think there is a natural evolution. CPP is still a client of ours. They used to be a very important client of ours. They don't do anything with us much anymore.
That's his way of saying we're not an important client.
Well, no, you're still a client, but they don't feel that they need us. And there are a number of other CPP equivalents in the world, and it's a bit of a natural evolution. And so for us to work with a CPP, we have to have a specific expertise by asset type or by geography or something to make them say, we can't do this ourselves. We need to do this with some third party.
Yeah, I think people, organizations started by sort of leasing and, renting human infrastructure across these markets. You know, some of the big organizations have built out teams, Sikh, from your history. They have teams on the ground. So it's, we call it the DIY, the do-it-yourself crowd. But I think a lot of them are also realizing that even if you have a team, there's still interesting things to do that your team may not be the best in. And I think it's put a lot of pressure on all of us as investors to have a very clear value proposition. Something that we do, that you do, that you're really good at, that you have a competitive advantage. And I think, I think the successful firms are finding those, and will be successful with a broad range of capital because they're adding value.
Mike? For us, clearly one example where we've seen investors who have been less interested in going into funds, but are interested in accessing core assets early. The best way to do that is actually to develop them. So the development competence is something which for us strategically has been important in forming the basis for joint ventures with many of these same groups who in the past might have been investing in funds and now are investing in joint venture structures.
And Seek, our equivalent to that is separate accounts. Separate accounts.
Okay.
Where the CPPIBs of the world are not going to invest in our funds anymore. There's lack of control. They don't control the strategy, the entry, the exit, nothing. But a lot of the big institutional investors will say, whether it's to BlackRock, Tishman, Speyer, or us, we'll give you a lot of money. Here's the strategy. Sometimes we want to control the investment decisions, and we certainly want to control the exit. And that is a very clear trend.
But I think that's sort of a clear sort of make versus lease decision by the deployers of capital. And you have in the development business, there's a value for having been in these markets for a long time and existing relationships. And I think all the successful organizations have or are in the process of figuring out what they're good at and doing more of that.
Good. Let's just we've been talking about massive amount of moving, but it looks like in more recent years you're seeing a lot of massive flows of capital from Asia to the developed market. And some of us who are old enough, we saw that happen when the Japanese in the 80s moved massive amount overseas, and we knew what happened to that. Can we see some parallels?
The answer is yes. I think it's driven by slightly different things. And Michael touched on sustainability for a second. What's interesting to me is the Asian investors, as a rule, don't care about sustainability. So that's one difference that we haven't talked about, which is just worth mentioning, because many other investors have that very high on their lists. I don't see the leverage levels being the same. And for many of these Asian investors, the pressure on them in their pension funds or sovereign wealth funds to invest, they're just floating in money. And the Japanese, when they arrived, whenever that was, a long time ago, they were primarily insurance companies. And so they actually needed their money back at some point in time. These Asian pension funds are pretty close to permanent investors, as close as you're going to come. And they're not leveraging very highly. And I see it as more sustainable. The one question mark in my mind is the geopolitical risk. If something happens to the political structure of China or the financial stability of China, then what?
Jack, how do you see this?
I think John's right. I think it's different pools of capital. It's long-dated, a lot of it's long-dated pension fund capital. You know, some of it is individual capital that it does have an element of flight capital to it. When the Japanese came, there was a lot of do-it-yourself mentality. But there's the Australians have come. There's been a whole sort of flow of offshore capital that have come here. And my sense is the groups that are coming now are trying to get control, trying to work with good local partners in separate account type relationships. I think they've learned from the things that didn't work from the folks that came before them. And they have some very real pressures that, you know, those pools of capital, those are young populations that capital is building up. They have to find yield. They have to find a place to put that capital. Their domestic markets, simply can't absorb that much capital, so they have to go overseas. And so it's a slightly different rationale. They're coming in late in the cycle, which always makes you wonder if it's going to turn out poorly. But I think they continue to invest at a time when a lot of domestic investors are still investing too. So I think they're just part of the landscape now.
Well, Michael, Tishman invests, in fact, you develop directly a lot of stuff in China. How do you see it from inside out?
Well, we've seen a tremendous amount of activity both within China and actually in the last 5 years. The capital we've invested in China has been primarily Chinese capital, right? And we've also seen many of the same investors very keenly focused on, you know, the gateway cities in the U.S. and Europe. I think it's hard to generalize. If I have any concern, it's some of the newest comers, right? The late comers in terms of joining the party, and they're in a hurry, right? So there's a bit of a catch-up dynamic among certain players. I think the other thing you could probably generalize, it's one thing. I think most of the institutional capital is well-managed, responsible, and then you occasionally see some cowboys, and you wonder, how is this going to end, you know? I think we and probably everybody on the stage is very, very busy meeting and engaged with all kinds of new institutional capital from Asia that's active now globally. Back to where we started, if you compare where we are today with 20 years ago, as Seek, you mentioned, the number of players who actually you can speak to back when you were going through the chronology, it really was the case where you could count on one hand the number of groups you could speak to could speak intelligently about different, more than one continent on Earth, right? And now you can't, you don't know how many that would be. You know?
Absolutely. Peter, do you see some of these new global investors trying to write on your experience?
I wouldn't describe it that way. No, I think these are, and it's hard to generalize. First of all, I prefer not to generalize about a whole country and their investors, et cetera, but a few observations. We are referring a lot to Chinese investors. I think they're similar to that. There's many different types of pools of capital in the U.S. and Canada. There's different types of pools in China too. I think one of the big differentiators, which is why I find it hard to make predictions, is that it is relatively opaque. So we don't really understand, or at least I don't understand their objectives, necessarily their commitment to real estate, et cetera. So I do think that's hard. It's harder to make predictions. I do think they are seeing the returns that other investors are making, so they're attracted to that, but that doesn't necessarily make them less sophisticated or more sophisticated. So that's one observation. The other part, which is more factual, is they are new, at least new to the US as investors. And there is been a long history of new investors making more mistakes than seasoned investors. I think rookies make mistakes, we all know that. It doesn't mean they're not smarter, it just means they haven't learned. And so I do think that there is a higher likelihood of mistakes made when you're a new investor, and that does not apply exclusively to Chinese investors. I'm not going to name. There's European investors that have made some mistakes, Canadian investors, American investors. So I think it's a rookie mistake, perhaps, than just a country mistake.
I used to say that prepare to pay tuition fees when you first enter a new market. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. And so the trick is take very, very small steps. But
I'm sorry, you have to understand how ironic Sikh's question of Peter was. Because in the introduction, it wasn't made clear that Sikh was the one who ran real estate at the Government of Singapore Investment Corporation for 20 years and made it the preeminent, sorry, Peter, the preeminent global sovereign investor in real estate, full stop. So I think an awful lot of people have played off the back of what he's done. And maybe CPP's one.
I didn't know if I was allowed to mention that.
That's why I can ask the questions now. I'm not running anymore. I explain how to do it. But going back to, we mentioned a few times about geopolitical risks, and certainly China came out as a potential risk if something's significant, some significant upheaval in that country that may affect that flow. And that is, this is historically for the first time you see an emerging market becoming a major source of capital, export, outflows of capital. But there are two other things. One has just happened called Brexit, and the other one is called the US elections. So now maybe we could start with Brexit. But how and have this affected where capital is going to be, or how capital is going to be invested? Let's start with Brexit. It's happened.
All right. Well, since I'm the one who at least still lives in the UK, unlike Mr. Spies, who just left because he thought the US had less geopolitical risk. What's really interesting is that if you go around and talk to all the real estate owners in London, in terms of their rental experience, it's been largely a non-event. And there was a bit of a pause for a couple weeks. Yep, there was a bit of a pause. But then almost all of the leases that were under negotiation pre the vote ended up being signed. And this is across asset types. This is across office buildings in the City of London, shopping centers, logistics. And so if you paid attention to the basic leasing fundamentals, a non-event. I think there was also a brief window when you could bargain hunt, but it was a very, very brief window, maybe of a couple weeks. If that. And now I would tell you prices are pretty much where they were, maybe a tad softer. What's in the background, though, is that we still really have no idea what Brexit is going to mean. And the level of uncertainty as we talk about geopolitical risks, if you scroll out a few years, is really, really hard to know. Has that impacted the capital flows for real estate? No. But when you're Nissan and you're talking about putting a new car manufacturing plant in Sunderland in the north of England, is that going to impact your thinking? I'd be surprised if it doesn't. So I think we still have to wait and see, but we're only at the beginning of the story.
Well, Michael lived there, or still lives there. He was just beginning to come back.
Two more weeks.
For about 30 years, he was on the ground in the UK. Perhaps you have a view on Brexit, too.
Yeah, no, I think it... Look,
you were there when it happened.
I was actually on a plane somewhere. I think it's a very, very unfortunate decision,
to say the least.
and just building on what John said, near term, look, at the moment, and what we should sort of, the market, the London market specifically always has a very good way to manage message, right? So for the moment, because the floor didn't fall out, everybody's calm, right? But now, what does this all mean, though? And the fact is, in 2 years from today, we will not know anything more, right? And it could be that in 3-4 years, we won't know a whole lot more. And the whole way this thing unfolds, unfortunately, just will create uncertainty, not just in Britain, but in Europe more broadly, and globally, too. So it's just, it's not good for anybody. And the other point I'd make is actually the thing I grow more and more concerned about is just the real implications are whatever the outcome within Britain is, it's going to be expensive, right? And the negotiating dynamic with Europe is not exactly favorable, right? So it's just going to be more expensive. So the fiscal equation, what comes out of all this in a country with as probably bigger challenges than the insanity we're seeing in the US right now in terms of the North-South divide, right? The North-South divide in Britain is the underlying political dynamic that's going to continue. London's 15% of the votes, doesn't matter. But it's a lot more, it's 30%+ of the revenue. And I think, you know, the real question is, how is this all going to get paid for? And I think tax, transactional costs, and that kind of risk across the board, it's not just in Britain. I think this is going to be something that's going to be one of the issues of the coming period that we all have to think about, but it's going to have an impact on what we think it's going to cost to transact and to hold property.
I think there's a bit of a cautionary tale for us looking at Brexit, given where we are in the electoral cycle. Because I think one of the things we saw was a bit of a buyer's strike for a quarter or two before Brexit. The market got it wrong. The listed market collapsed 15-30% in a day. There was one or two deals got done. Everyone ran around with their proverbial hair on fire. And then you fast forward 3 or 4 months, the open-end funds have entry queues to them. London office buildings aren't worth quite as much as they were before. But things are going on. But I think, as Michael, as you said, with a view that the long-term arrow is probably tilting down. It was probably tilting sideways, and now it's probably tilting down.
We're very quickly coming to the end of the discussion. Just very quickly, the U.S. election. You're the resident American, the rest are not. What do you think?
I would like to point out that where Michael lives seems to be a leading indicator. He was in the UK on June 23rd. He has now moved to the United States, and now look at the state we're in. So if Michael moves to your country, beware.
I'm not worried. So, I'm not worried.
Jack.
Yeah, so listen, I think the...
We're not asking you to predict who's going to win.
Oh, listen, I think the interest, American interest in Vancouver apartments has cooled down slightly in the last 30 or 45 days. Listen, I think we're all operating without a net here. I think I think as we look back on the process, it's going to be a very difficult governance period across in the White House and the other two houses, no matter what happens here. And I think, as a citizen, it's going to be a real challenge to get the kind of things done that we need to get done.
I think that hopefully everybody will have been sufficiently exhausted and concerned to recognize this is not a sport. You know, this is stuff that's
this is about to end.
The absence of constructive dialogue and leadership is it's just got to stop.
Any last words on the U.S. election? For Canadian?
No, we don't comment on U.S.
You
politics.
Have to build the wall.
I'll say this.
You have your own excitement up there, though.
I definitely won't say that. I mean, part of our jobs is to assess risk. And so I'm going to say two things that sound conflicted. One, we continue to be very interested in the UK as a market, and regardless of the outcome in the upcoming presidential election, we are going to be very interested in the US. These are two great markets for a lot of other reasons. The question is, what return are you required to get in these markets? And if you look at Britain right now, it's a riskier place today than it was 6 months ago. So theoretically, you should have a higher return. And when you underwrite, it depends on the assets. If you're trying to buy an asset at Canary Wharf today, you'd have to use very different assumptions than you would 6 months ago. So it's all factors into your assumptions and return expectations, as opposed to a binary decision, London on, London off.